Disco Elysium takes place in an incredibly bleak universe. The town of Martinez is a war-torn ruin, where old men play bocce ball in bomb craters, preteens do drugs and curse like sailors, and a dead body stinking up the streets for days is treated as a mild inconvenience. Even our protagonist, Harry Dubois, drives home this melancholy world-building. He wakes up in a room he trashed in a drunken stupor, and as we find out more about the events that led up to his blackout, we learn that he spent several days in a suicidal rage. But that's just the setting and the backstory. The in-game events are bleak too. Harry can sleep in a literal dumpster, punch a kid, call his ex-wife, and even when he tries to get closure with her in a dream, it ends in pathetic fashion. I've spoken before about the hope and inspiration you can gain from playing this game, but that doesn't overrule the fact that this is about as depressing and heartbreaking of a universe as you'll find in a video game. It's always raining in Revachol. Literally, or metaphorically. There are so few rays of sunshine. Except for Harry's stalwart partner, Kim Kitsuragi. Throughout Disco Elysium, Kim serves as a bright spot in both Martinez and in Harry's life, inspiring him to be a better person, a better cop, and to at last put the sorrows of the past behind him. We meet Kim on day one, right after Harry has pulled himself together, well, somewhat pulled himself together, and comes downstairs to the first floor of the Whirling in Rags. Right away, we're told by esprit de corps that although Kim does not yet know Harry at all, that he'd be willing to lay down his life for him. It's early in the game, but this remains one hell of a statement. In Martinez, we are constantly beset by people who are anything but selfless, who are wholly unwilling to help others unless it in some way benefits them. Everard Clare, the union boss, sends Harry to do his dirty work in exchange for information about his missing gun. Joyce, the negotiator sent by the Wild Pines group, does the same thing with what she knows about the mercenaries. Colossia is shrouded in mystery, but if there's one thing that's clear about her, it's that she's out for her own skin, over and above everything else. This is not a world where people go out of their way to lend a hand to someone in need. And yet, within seconds of meeting him, Kim would take a bullet for Harry on principle alone. Of course, this personality trait isn't just something noticed by the voices in Harry's head. It's something he demonstrates throughout the game. If Harry doesn't have enough money to pay for his room on the first night of the game, Kim will offer to let him pawn a set of hubcap spinners he confiscated, presumably along with that spinner belt that John Cena used to wear. In any case, the resulting real is enough for Harry to not only get a place to stay for the evening, but also to pay off the damages to the room and his ridiculously large drink bill. It's a gesture that goes beyond kindness. It's a selfless act that truly stands out in a place as cutthroat as Martinez. Of course, Kim's finest moment comes during the tribunal. No matter how the encounter goes for you, whether you choose to make the spirit bomb and throw it at Raul, shoot him, or fail to do so altogether, Harry will eventually be shot in the leg and taken out of the fight. Despite the fact that there's an active firefight going on, despite the fact that there is at least one, possibly even two, unscathed and dangerous mercenaries armed with semi-automatic weapons right behind him, Kim doesn't hesitate to try and save Harry's life. He doesn't try to reload his weapon and get another shot off. He doesn't run for cover or try to protect himself. He leaps on his wounded comrade, who is at best an extremely aloof detective, or at worst, a cop in an addictive doom spiral, and does everything he can to keep him alive. It's easy to forget about with everything else going on. Titus charging into the fight, the Hardy Boys coming to his aid, and the voices in Harry's head proclaiming certain doom. But Kim puts himself at great risk by doing this in the first place. He literally turns his back to the enemy, and he's so engrossed in trying to save his partner of only a few days that only a last-minute intervention from Harry can save him. It's an incredibly selfless act, one that says so much about who Kim is as a person, and proves what esprit de corps said the morning we first met him. He is who he says he is, and in a world where Harry can't even remember who he is forced to work for people who are incredibly corrupt and can't even rely on his own former squadmates to be forthcoming, That's a beautiful thing. Every Harry is different. Yours took a far different path than mine, no doubt. But across the multiverse of Disco Elysiums, I think it's inarguable that Kim has a positive influence on Harry. Circling back to the Tribunal, we see this in its climactic moment, when Kim is about to be shot by one of the mercenaries. If Harry has gotten himself together, if he's done good work as a cop, stayed sober, and proven that he's a strong detective despite his troubles, then you get a bonus to your authority role. If he's gone above and beyond in this regard, then it's an even heftier bonus. For me, this was far and away the most heartwarming moment of the game, a moment that brings tears to my eyes every time I play it. It's not just a mechanic that rewards the player for helping Harry turn himself around, for putting the past behind him. It's a moment of synergy between Kim and Harry, between gameplay and story, that shows that the path we've guided Harry down really does matter. And it's evidence that Kim's impact on Harry is profoundly positive. If Kim truly trusts Harry at this point in the game, it's not just because he's done a good job on the case. It's because he's proven himself to be a decent person as well. A person capable of empathizing with a woman who just lost her husband, of backing up his partner in the face of a racist lorry driver, and convincing a kooky bookstore owner that she needs to step up as a parent. He trusts him because he's grown and changed. Though Kim probably wouldn't want to take credit for it, there's no doubt in my mind that his influence helped Harry reach this point. If Harry makes it to the end of the game with Kim by his side and has managed to stay sober, then Kim will give him a heartwarming recommendation, and Jean McMahon will have no choice but to welcome Harry back to the Force. Kim supports Harry through the final conversation with Jean, vouching for his skills as a cop, and backing him up on the discovery of the Phasmid. This moment isn't just a culmination of how Kim has helped Harry grow throughout the game, it's also a demonstration of how Kim is continually dedicated to his partner, and how he might continue to help him grow in the future. In one of the game's endings, Harry has the option of inviting Kim to join Precinct 41. It's unfortunate that there probably won't be a Disco Elysium 2, because I'd love to see the influence Kim might have on Harry as he continues to recover from his past. Hell, with Kim by his side, Harry might actually be able to put Dora in the rearview mirror, as difficult as that would be for him. In my last Disco Elysium video, I argued that the ultimate inspiring message behind the game is that if even someone as messed up as Harry can overcome his hardships, then so can you. Well, my friend, I'd like to add to that and say that if you are going through some stuff right now, then I hope you've got a Kim Kitsuragi in your life, someone who inspires you to be the best person you can be, someone who makes you a better person just by being in their presence. He's a selfless man in a selfish world. He's the greatest partner of all time, the best coworker you could ever ask for. And that's what makes him so important. Thanks for watching. Special shout out to Paul Looney for allowing me to use his song God Please, a fan theme for Kim, for this video. Paul is an incredible musician who's created fan songs for a number of video games, including Fallout, Hollow Knight, and of course, Disco Elysium. You can check out his channel by following the link in the description box. This is the first video in a planned series of essays that will cover the narrative importance of key characters from Disco Elysium. Next up, I'll be covering Dora, in a video I hope to drop sometime in September. But first, I'll be diving back into Revenant Hill, as we'll take a look at the promotional images from the game and see what we can learn from them. See you guys then!